We're coming to you live from Rare HQ in the beautiful Warwickshire countryside. I'm Xbox UK's Kate Gray.
I'm Martin Littlewood. Hello.
For the next 6 hours, we're going to be celebrating the release of Rare Replay, which comes out on August the 4th, with a host of amazing guests. It's the first new title in the greatest games lineup in Xbox history. Have a look at our guests now. They are.
Ooh, look at them. They look amazing. Right, enough of them. It's fine. Right. Over the next couple of hours, we are going to be playing through all 30 games inside of the collection. We're going to be speaking to a host of devs, and we even have a few game challenges as well.
Which I'm going to fail. We're also going to be showing you a few exclusive interviews, an amazing studio tour, and we're going to be announcing the winners of our Twitter giveaway competition, you lucky things, as well as giving away some codes. But where do we start with six generations of gaming? How about 1998? Better place than any, really? But first of all, why don't you check out the trailer one more time?
You never forget your first game. And the more of them you play, the more of them you love. Every memory is a story to cherish and share. We fought back monsters, soared across the stars, achieved the impossible. We were heroes. There were games that blew us apart and games that brought us together. Whether you're reliving childhood memories or discovering classics for the first time, you'll see why the best stories will never be forgotten.
Exclusive.
Hey guys,
hey.
We're here with Greg. Martin's still here.
Hi.
But Greg is the creator of Banjo-Kazoo, which we're about to play. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful?
There we go, I'm hitting play. It's all good.
Takes me back a bit, this does. I don't think I've actually played this since I finished the game back in 1998.
Wow.
Really?
Okay. It'll be,
I don't think I've played it since then either.
I've actually just played this about 2 weeks ago.
Probably clearly know more about
yeah,
it than
I picked up a copy of it at Comic-Con because I realised I'd not delved into many of the Rare games, and yeah, I just ended up having a blast with it. I've actually just started on Tui as well.
Nice.
Which is really, really fun.
Oh, God, I haven't prepared this much. I was like, you know what, let's just jump into the game and then it'll all come flooding back.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't, then I'll just make something
I will say this is the one out of 30 games today that I've actually played. Maybe Perfect Dark Zero a little bit as well.
You shouldn't be admitting to that.
No, I should, because this is a great way for me to discover games. Everybody else as well, I'm sure there's plenty of people in the chat, like Escapist and everybody else, who have never played some of these games before, because they might have been before their time.
Well, hello everyone in the chat.
Hi.
Nice to see you.
We can see the Twitch chat.
And while we're waiting for the game to load up, I want to ask you some questions. So, maybe some of the people in the chat are newbies, because, you know, some of them might even be younger than this game. That's nice to think about, isn't it?
We've certainly got people at the company that are younger than I was when I started at Rare. So
wow.
I've been here 25 years, and some of our employees are kind of younger than that, so
weird.
That is weird.
Well, okay, if you can describe it, the game.
The game, Banjo, it's a 3D platform adventure game, kind of set in a fantastical fairy tale world, which kind of centres around the duo of Banjo, a bear, and Kazooie is a kind of a partner that lives in his backpack, who's a bird, and they're up against the evil witch Gruntilda.
It's obvious stuff, isn't it?
It is really.
It's a proper fairy tale kind of thing.
The story doesn't really take much understanding.
What made you go for a bear and a bird?
That's a long story, but I guess we've got quite a while.
We
so,
do. Go for it.
The bear was in a previous game called Dream, which I think a lot of people know about or have heard about. It was an adventure game, and his backpack was a tool to put objects in. Obviously, on adventure games, you collect loads of stuff, and the backpack was for that. But Dream didn't go anywhere, but we liked the character, so we thought, can we take the character and put it in another game?
Mm-hmm. And you did.
And we did. and then Kazooie was added later. I mean, she wasn't there at the start. I wanted a double jump move, for Banjo to jump in the air, then jump again. And we tried putting it in, and it just looked odd that the character could jump in midair.
Yeah.
So basically, Kazooie was a way of explaining why Banjo could jump in midair. It was like, oh, let's just make a pair of wings appear out of this backpack and perform this double jump. And that was it. We left it as a pair of wings for a while.
Even in 1998, you're questioning, you know, all these game mechanics that just exist, and no one ever questions them. They're everyone can jump in midair,
everyone has wings in their backpacks. I went to school, I know that much.
Well, and then later on we added the legs, because I wanted, Banjo's quite slow, because he's a bear, he's quite ponderous, and it was wrong that he could run really fast. When we put him in running really fast, it just looked silly. So, again, it's like, can we use the backpack to explain away this kind of thing?
So was it very much a case of picking the gameplay mechanics that you wanted and make them work to the animals? Yeah. Or did you sit down and go, right, a bear can do this, and this?
No, it was very much the abilities you wanted them to do.
Right, okay.
Whereas the levels, the worlds themselves were the opposite, like you just said. It was, we'd pick a theme and then kind of think up all the ideas in that theme. So like on the beach level, like, oh, we're going to have a pirate ship, of course.
Yeah.
We're going to have a lighthouse. There's going to be palm trees, treasure chest, here, all the kind of things, of a giant crab, all the things you expect.
How do you go about picking all the different themes? Because they'd be very massively. We've got like a haunted house. We've got like Rust Bucket Bay, all these other kinds of places. They just seem to be like corner.
I guess you've just answered your own question. It's like, we wanted a wide variety. Just of levels that. So when you kind of go to a new world, it feels like a new experience, and a different emotion as well. Like, obviously on a dark kind of haunted house level, the emotions you kind of feel on that level are very different to a nice open beach, or when you're swimming underwater and the kind of clanker comes out of the gloom. They're all kind of designed to evoke different emotions. We wanted each level to kind of feel like it had its own identity and its own emotions.
Nice. What was your, out of all those levels then, which one would you say from the original Banjo is your favourite?
That's a tricky one. I'd probably say Rusty Bucket Bay, I think.
I just
like the idea. One, it's a ship and I love ships, but two, the whole level was built around the ship. It wasn't like there was a few buildings around the outside, but the whole thing was a ship. And And certainly, I think the engine room was one of those bits in the game which kind of got your heart racing. It's like, because in the first Banjo, you had to collect all the notes in one go, and if you died, you lost them all. So by the time you got to the engine room with its kind of spinning kind of drive shafts, it was like your palms were sweating, your heart was beating. So you certainly wouldn't leave those to the end. You'd usually get those first.
Let's see if we can get to that level.
Amazing.
In the next.
I'm trying to get Kazooie's legs out. I'm not sure how it works on this controller. What do you reckon?
It'll be down. It'll be triggering down in some way.
Okay. Yeah. I've tried the D-pad.
I like that you're getting all this muscle memory coming back.
Yeah.
Well,
I played it with the N64 controller as well.
Yeah.
Maybe we need like an instruction manual.
Yeah. Gone are the day of the booklets in video games, unfortunately. it's not going to happen, is it?
No. Just keep going. It's going to be one.
Keep going. All the buttons. Just mash. Mash. Everyone in the chat's like, left on the D-pad. I know this.
I know
that's where the C-stick used to live. There you go. Somebody actually
nice.
Thanks.
Jeff86.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Both triggers, apparently. That makes sense.
It's pretty straightforward.
There we go.
Probably we didn't know that.
I know. This is why I'm playing the games and not asking the questions.
You're a fake gamer.
I'm useless.
What you are.
Wow. Bringing that into question in what, like 10 minutes into the stream?
Yeah. I'm going to question everyone's gaming ability until I emerge victorious as the only real gamer.
Wow, we'll see. I know you're scared about the perfect dart segment later on.
I'm really out.
I'm going to wait for that to surface.
I'm not good at that. I'm not good at aiming. That's like my one weakness.
Oh man, I love this game so much. I had such a blast of it over the last couple of weeks. What was the kind of the thought process in terms of having the quiz at the end? That's something that I've never seen done in the game myself.
Yeah, that was. I think I was just looking for a different way to end the game.
Yeah.
Obviously, you expected some kind of showdown with a witch at some point. But,
yeah.
But before then, it was just, what can we do that's different that players don't expect? Mm. And I'm not sure where the quiz came from. I've always got a soft spot for quizzes, but it just seemed like one of those little ideas that suddenly gained momentum. All it was originally was, let's ask the player a few questions over the game they've just been playing to see if they've been observant. And then it kind of ballooned out from that into this kind of like almost board game-esque.
So you find her throughout. You find this lady here throughout, like the course of the game, don't you? In different areas.
Yes, and
she gives you all the answers.
She gives you the answers. She gives you Gruntilda's secrets.
Yeah,
like the best.
It's everything from like, you know, what's her favourite flavour to like what was her nickname in school. Like, I feel like there's this extensive backstory going on.
So I kind of feel sad for her at the end. You're like, oh no one likes her. No wonder she wants to be pretty.
You do. She gets quite the raw deal. Like in the second game, she comes back and she's only a head.
Yeah. She's nothing but bones in the second one.
Yeah, that's the bones in the second one, isn't it? That's right, the head in the third one. There's not really much left of her.
Oh, little Jinjo. Where did the Jinjos come from, by the way? Because again, they're very random. I love, like, I'm really into the whole collectible thing, but the Jinjos just seem very different. Because all the other ones are like static items, the jiggies, the music notes, whereas the Jinjos are like these actual living creatures. And in the second one, they take on a good role.
I guess that's something you see in a lot of games of the time, where you collect a certain number of things on a level.
Yeah.
But we wanted to kind of inject a bit of, as with everything in Banjo, we try to give everything character, so that's why everything's got eyes, the heads are animating up there.
Yeah.
And it was the same with these objects, we wanted them to have personality and character, so that's where the fact it was a little character that was in distress.
Yeah.
Where did the eyes come from? Because I know you're kind of trademark at Rare.
Yeah, I think
it's just got eyes on everything.
It was just to kind of inject personality into something. Yeah. As with a lot of things, they start off either as a joke or by accident, and then they actually become, oh, that's a really good idea. Let's go to town on that. We'd never have a master plan of right, everything's going to have eyes. It would start kind of simple with something small, and then we just keep adding them. Again, it was just trying to inject personality and character into the game, which is, I think, one of the things certain players remember about Banjo is the character and the humour. And it was a lot of the script was ad lib. We wrote as we went along, but it certainly wasn't. We didn't sit there thinking about it trying to be funny. We wanted it to feel like characters were talking to each other as they would in real life.
Yeah.
So they'd have these everyday problems and kind of everyday kind of.
Because Kazooie's pretty sassy, I'm not going to lie. She's quite blunt with people.
Cheers.
Well, I thought that adds to her charm a
little bit. There was a few comments she did have that we did have to take out.
Oh, really?
To make the E rating, it was we wanted to push it as far as we could.
Are they stream friendly? Do you remember any of them?
Probably not.
I think I've even rated mature because of Conker anyway.
I think 15 years since past, I think it's probably quite tame, but we'll stay on the safe side and not mention anything.
we won't disrupt the overlords.
They weren't anything like Conker, they were just a little bit near the knuckle.
Oh,
what have you done? So, can't do that on a stream.
I'm sorry, Twitch chat are going to rip me apart.
They really are.
F to pay respect.
This shows you kind of a.
There's loads of really nice stuff in the chat, by the way. Not many questions.
Surprising for a Twitch chat. If you do have any questions, by the way, everybody, be sure to put them in the chat and we'll relay them into the stream throughout the entirety of the stream as well. Oh, God. Right, what am I doing here? I'm trying to work out what I've got left to do. Of course, the musical notes I've already sent, haven't they?
That's right, you've got to go.
I've got to go get all 100 again. Luckily, everything like the Jinjos and stuff like that stay the same. Yeah. Was there a reasoning behind that? Like, it's the only thing in the game that doesn't remain as a constant when you die.
The Jinjos?
Yeah, no, the musical notes. So the musical notes reset to zero if you die, but everything else you
everything
keep.
Else collect. I think we wanted a kind of a balance. I think if everything reset, it would have been a bit too harsh.
Yeah, a bit punishing.
So the notes were kind of the kind of balance that's out. And in the second game, we actually changed the system, so it kind of remembered. And I think people were split. Some people liked the idea that we had to collect them all in one go in the first game. Others liked the fact that we were being a bit kinder in the second game. So
I've not got the boots yet, so I can't go and transform.
No, so you're not going there.
No, because I wanted to ask you about Mumbo. You were talking before about like having mechanics work around the animals.
Yeah.
In each of the levels, was it a case of picking the theme and then picking a Mumbo transformation afterwards, or is it like, hey, it'd be really cool if you could turn into a little crocodile or into an ant?
It would be based on the level. The level, the world would be the thing that led it.
Like, yeah.
we want a Mumbai transformation on the swamp level here. What could we pick and what's going to be funny?
Yeah.
And then once we decide on the character, we then kind of work out what tasks the transformation is going to be.
Yeah. I've not got the gold feathers, so no. I can't say principle
just yet. Not much of anything, really.
All right, this is where my terrible platforming skills come into play.
Better you than me, really.
Definitely, or me. Last time I tried to play this, it wasn't a pretty sight.
Got to try and get up through the tree houses. I'm just like scanning the chat now for any questions that people have.
People
as well.
Are asking, here we go. Chris Goin says, what sort of behind the scenes stuff is in Rare Replay?
I couldn't tell you, to be honest. I'm not gonna try and make it up. I don't know. I don't know what's in there.
Well, we've had a word with a few of the other developers who are working on Rare Replay, and there's lots of documentary stuff, I believe.
There's definitely a documentary behind the making of Banjo Kazooie. I'm in it, yeah. So yeah. I can remember that much. So. But yeah, so people get to hear.
There's a lot of challenges that you can unlock.
Somebody in the chat was asking as well, was there anything that you really wanted to have in the game, anything you fought for that didn't ultimately get in there?
That didn't get in there. That's a tough one. There were certainly kind of worlds that we considered doing and kind of half started that we then kind of realised we hadn't got time to put in, so we'd stop them. But no, I think as a whole, Banjo is a game where what you actually see in it is kind of pretty much what we wanted. As with every game, there's always things that you would have liked
to
give more time and some of the stuff that did appear in Tui, like the mine level, for instance, in Tui, was originally designed for Banjo, for Kazooie. The design existed, but we just didn't have time or think we needed any more levels, so we just kind of shipped it off to something.
Got you. Okay.
You're being asked, where did you get your shirt?
The shirt? This shirt is circa, year 2000. It's a Banjo-Tooie, so...
It is very stylish.
It's embroidered as well, it's
definitely embroidered.
It's not just printed on. Fancy stuff.
So I've got all these in my garage at home, so I had a bit of a rummage around before I came here today. dusted off these things that I haven't worn for 15 years or so.
Was there any stuff in Banjo-Kazooie that you ended up putting in Banjo-Tooie instead?
Yes, there was definitely the mine level.
Mm-hmm.
And there was other ideas, like we were toying with the idea of splitting Banjo and Kazooie up in this game, but felt it was probably a bit too much, so again we just kind of left that over. But mostly it was ideas for worlds. We had probably 20, 25 ideas, really nice ideas for worlds that we could have included. Some of them made it into Kazooie, some of them made them into Tui, and then some of them just didn't, just never saw the light of day. So.
Yeah. Was there anything, kind of on the same topic, was there anything in terms of the console's power at the time and capabilities that kind of hindered any other abilities or any mechanics that you wanted to have?
No, I think I'm not a technical person by any means, but... we did a lot of work on kind of culling the background, which is removing bits you can't see.
Mm-hmm.
So you think that the whole background's being drawn at once, but it's not. It only actually draws what you can see. And kind of up to that time, doing that in the game wasn't that commonplace. But in order to get the kind of level of detail into the worlds we've got, we had some fairly clever software going on that was basically not drawing the levels you could see.
Yeah. One big difference I noticed actually between, because I've just recently started playing 2 myself, and I've just finished Kazooie before that, is that one big difference I found was that in a Kazooie level, you can typically see the whole level from pretty much the central standing point, whereas there's a lot more kind of walls and dividing areas and stuff for 2E. Was that kind of a decision, or like was that a decision made in terms of like you want people to kind of go down different alleys?
There's probably... there's a couple of things, kind of deliberately hiding things away is kind of part of the level design. Like if you could see absolutely everything, it kind of takes away from the kind of intrigue and mystery. There always has to be that, oh, I wonder what's around the other side of the tree.
Yeah.
But then again, having these kind of awesome vistas where you can see across levels, or you go up really high and you get a sense of vertigo looking down.
Definitely got that on the lighthouse.
That was probably the first time where we had that real... first sense of emotion being that high, so we tried to push it as high as we possibly could.
Amazing.
And still being able to draw the beach below. But no, it's like kind of, and then you've got to think about the limits. of the hardware what we can actually draw. Yeah. So kind of all of those mixed together, you want blocks to pop, you want players to see things, and the limits. It's just you try and find the right balance between those three things.
Yeah, not sacrificing too much, but still having that really like special experience. Somebody asked in the chat as well, I noticed this, somebody said, what's Mumbo's origin story? does he have one?
Not a particularly detailed one, that's for sure.
Because Mumbo doesn't really like to give him the time of day, I've noticed. She very much palms him off.
No, he was... the thing is, we wanted Banjo to change into things. That kind of led the idea. So we wanted... As with everything in Banjo, we wanted it to be character-based, so we wanted a character that could change Banjo into things, so we kind of thought, what could that be? And obviously, like a shaman-esque witch doctor would make an interesting character, so that's where Mumbo was born. And it just went from there, and then the relationships between the characters were just added as we went, that we just thought would make entertaining viewing, like Kazooie and Mumbo don't get on.
Yeah.
Mumbo's okay with Banjo. Banjo and Kazooie kind of get on, and they've got this kind of happy relationship, but then there's friction between the characters.
Yeah.
And then when we introduced Humble Wumba and Tui, she doesn't get on with Mumbo. So we just got layering all this on top, and it got to the point where it's quite difficult to remember like the relationships between the characters when you're trying to write the dialogue.
Yeah.
Basically a soap opera.
Yeah, it's exactly right. Some of the tasks that you got given, it did feel like this kind of in-game soap opera with all these characters with these almost real-world personal problems that basically you were there to solve.
Speaking of the characters as well, obviously the characters are voiced to an extent. They have like a little kind of ticker reel of different sound effects they make. Was there ever any consideration for having them actually like read out the text, as in like read the scripts out?
As in
in full length.
Proper voice.
Yeah.
Yeah, we did consider it. Our first idea, we had this. It was like a kind of a bubble speak idea we called it, where we tried to not have any text at all. Where characters would just have these little thought bubbles about what they wanted. So if someone had a problem, there'd be a picture of something in there. But we felt we couldn't convey enough information with that, so then we considered speech, but we didn't really felt it fitted the game, that what would Banjo sound like, what would these characters sound like. So then we thought, what can we do instead that kind of gives the game character? And then we just thought about the kind of almost like kind of mumbling idea of kind of it sounds like a talking, and each character can have its own personality and identity, but it's all done by a mumbler.
Yeah.
And it just went from there. We did a couple of voices as a test. Everyone thought it was great, so therefore then everybody had to have this kind of mumbling speak, and it's kind of stuck with Banjo ever since. I think it'd be very difficult to voice the characters now. If
you were to revisit it,
By the way, we've only got 2 or 3 minutes left on this.
We're trying to
before we're going
to
start moving
the
on.
Room, I'm going to get away there.
Oh, God.
I want to see you do those.
I forgot that was the goal. That's probably...
Never mind.
I don't want to say my least favourite. It was my most frustrating level in the original.
Yeah, so once we've done with this bit, we're going to have a look at an interview, which I'll tell you more about in a minute. And then we're going to be playing Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts and Banjo-Tooie, as well as Attic Attack and Gunfright. So it's a nice mixture of games that we're going to be playing. But first, you've got to get to the engine room.
Have I really got to get there?
Yes.
Oh, okay, it's my bad.
Otherwise, you don't get paid.
Are you serious?
Ever.
Okay, I'll get there. Don't worry about it. I'm on my way.
Sorry. We're getting asked a lot, although I think maybe just from the one person over and over again, will we ever see a Banjo 3E?
I'm not answering that one on camera. no matter what I say, it'll be taken out of context.
Twitch
so,
never forgets.
No, they don't.
Would you call it Banjo 3E?
I think that'd be such an expected name now that we probably will call it something else.
Yeah, fair enough.
Where is it? It's just down here to the left, isn't it? Was it back
one? No, I don't know.
I'm trying to remember.
Just follow the. I'm going to go down one of the pipes, it might lead you.
Oh, no. She lied to me. Hold on.
See, everyone now in the chat is getting excited about Nuts and Bolts.
I think we're going to run out of time before you get there. Oh, you got the boots, haven't you?
Did I pick them up before? I did, yeah. I'm trying to remember where the room is now. I think it might be on the other side of Gruntilda's tree statue, isn't it?
I'll have to save that one for another day.
Yeah.
Never mind. Well, I think maybe... maybe that's a good time to share everyone the interview. Guys, we did an interview this time last week with Paul Collins, who he's kind of in charge of Rare Replay. So we had a chat to him about, you know, what it's like and how it's going to be. So take a look at that and we'll see you in a minute.
Rare Replay is a collection of 30 classic rare games spanning six generations of console gaming. When we kind of wanted to decide what those 30 games were, we kind of put a criteria in place that was, do they have amazing characters, do they have amazing worlds and just iconic gameplay that you just can't forget? And as we started to play through all the games just to find what that 30 should be, it was a good opportunity for me to play as many games as possible and kind of rekindle my own kind of memories. So probably the first kind of game that I played was Banjo-Kazooie. That was when I noticed Rare, and I said, well, okay, I need to pick up Blast Corps and Jet Force Gemini and try KI out now. Then, having the means to kind of find out what else Rare have been up to, I didn't realise that they made Battletoads and a few other games like Cobra Triangle and Slalom, even going back to when they were Ultimate to begin with as well, and I knew I played Jetpack with my dad too. So kind of going back, it's very hard if you're a gamer to not have actually been touched by one of Rare or Ultimate's games. Going back from a kid, like me and my brother would always fight, but for some reason we'd be fine when we played like a good co-op game. When we started playing through Battletoads, we just couldn't play it. It was just too hard for us. So we thought, oh, if we play it two-player, that's great. Then we can, when we get onto Turbo Tunnel, if one of us crashes, then we can still go on. But no, one of you dies, you're both out. That's always probably the best memory for me, us trying to complete Turbo Tunnel with two characters on the screen. It was just, yeah, I look forward to seeing some players trying to do that without using the rewind cheat. We've got a snapshot challenge in the game too, which is Infinite Turbo Tunnel. So for those that kind of sadistic among us, they can definitely give that a try and see how long they can survive for. All the snapshot challenges have leaderboards on them. So there's reasons to go back, reasons to play them again, reasons to best your friend's scores or times. And as you play through the snapshot challenges and the four games, you're also going to unlock bonus video content that we've made exclusively just for Rare Replay. We've spoke to developers past and present to ask them about like what their favourite games were. We've also talked to them about like the development process of some of the games like Blast Corps, Jet Force Gemini and Killer Instinct. There's just so much content inside the collection. If you're a fan of Rare, then we really believe that this has so many games on offer that like if you haven't played them before, or you maybe just played half of them, you haven't finished them yet, they're all in one place for you. And we've wanted to make this the best possible way to experience them too. And that for me is one of the key reasons why you should definitely get excited for it.